at the end of 3 years course, just before exams, this topic of tips for examination of the larynx may be a little odd, but as you keep growing in your service, examination of larynx is not that easy. The normal patient without any abnormalities like short neck, high placed larynx, or a very narrow oropharynx, or minimal trismus, if nothing is there, it is simple. That too, if you have practiced doing indirect laryngoscopy in OPD without spraying the throat. Suppose you have to learn certain things, if there are some basic mistakes which we tend to commit. So I would like to discuss how to do a laryngeal examination with the indirect laryngoscope, then what are the differences between it and the fiber optic laryngoscopy, Hopkins evaluation, direct laryngoscopy and micro laryngoscopy. Few words about stroboscope. So that will conclude most of the examination of the larynx. What is the goal of laryngeal examination? First thing is mapping the disease. So what is the gross disease? And it's not the neck also. And staging is very important to plan the treatment. And once we do the DL-scopy, we do the tissue diagnosis. So one is diagnosing, second is mapping, third is first staging. Now these are the usual armamentarium we have with the evolution. When I started my ED, we had only indirect laryngoscope in the departments, and that's how we had to learn how to use it effectively without any other help. Once during our evolution, once we got these flexible scopes, rigid scopes, then if I want to do the indirect laryngoscopy like my younger days, it becomes difficult because we are not used. Now indirect laryngoscopy is a quick, inexpensive, and it doesn't require much of the infrastructure. But what are the disadvantages? The subtle abnormalities, until unless you are an expert and the ideal situation in the larynx, you are tend to miss all the subtle abnormalities. And larynx is not in a physiological position. As the tongue is pulled out and larynx is elevated when you are examined. And some anatomic features like a high jetting upper incisors or a uvula hanging down, a soft palate or a large oral tongue or base of tongue will be obstructing the view. The hyperreflex gag patient, these are the most difficult to examine, whether it is Hopkins or indirect laryngoscopy. I have shown two pictures. Now, what is good about the first one and what is wrong in that picture? These pictures I selected from the textbooks, some of the books, not textbooks, and the second picture. So what is good in the first picture is, if you see the position of the eye of the examiner, it's at the level of the oral cavity. So when the patient opens the mouth, you are seeing directly onto the mirror without any parallax error. If your eyes are above, then you are looking down. If below, you are looking up. So what is something wrong in that is, you see this lower one, the upper lip, when you open the mouth, many patients' upper lip comes down. So it is better to use a finger to push it up. But be careful, In my initial days, when I didn't cut my nails, the patient scolded me because it hurt the mucosa. So we should have the proper nails also for that. And before doing the examination, explain to the patient what you are doing. You just put the mirror into the patient's mouth, they will close over the mirror. And when you heat the mirror, touch to the back of the hand, whether it is ideal temperature or too much or too less. If it is too less, it will be frosty. If it is too high, again they will shout at you. Now, when you are actually examining, if you notice, we always tell the PG, examine, do the phonation and see the mobility. But actually, we should examine the patient during phonation and during breathing. If you don't examine during breathing, we miss lot of times abductor palsy. The mild or moderate abductor palsy is missed if you don't examine during quiet or forced breathing. So in quiet breathing and deep breathing, you can assess the gentle abduction and extreme abduction. And most of the examination we do on phonation. So during phonation, most of you will observe only the vocal cords. How much they are moving? Is there any phonatory gap? What is the status of the vocal cord? Is it tense or it is bowing? But what we should see is the ventricles. It's only on adduction the ventricles open up. That's the time you can assess any lesion in the ventricles. Piriform fossae should be always observed during phonation, not during breathing. As the vocal cords adduct, the piriform opens up. So you have to assess the piriform fossae for the pooling or growth then only. If you do it during breathing, you cannot make out whether the growth is in the medial wall or lateral wall or where it is. Suppose you do it during phonation, you can easily make out the growth arising from the medial wall or lateral wall. Now about the rigid laryngoscopy or the Hopkin evaluation. It's again an office procedure. You can use 70 degree or 90 degree telescopes, pass through the mouth. Again, like direct laryngoscope, it's a non-physiological examination because you are pulling out the tongue and are asking them to phonate. But what is the advantage over the ideal? It is the high quality images and excellent magnification you will have. Of course, the anatomic and hyperreflexive patient is the limitation. But certain anatomic abnormalities or restrictions can be overcome with rigid telescope. Now again the method is same like ideal, but here you can do sitting or standing and you are looking into the image, not into the patient mouth. Flexible layer that allows the examination of the larynx under physiological position and along with nasopharynx, oropharynx and larynx, and all of them will be in the physiological positions. And it can be easily performed in patients with hyperreflexive gag and even pediatrics by using pediatric scopes, because here we normally use topical anesthesia. Now, video stroboscopy. The video stroboscopy can be done with flexible scope as shown in the left side and on the right side by the rigid scope. And it can be performed through the nose if you are using the flexible scopes, and it is very essential for vocal fold lesions. The mobility, the mucosal wave pattern, all that can be assessed, and it is also important to do this before surgery and after surgery also. And also helpful for early recurrences in CA glottis. So here you all know the physiology and the principle of stroboscopy, so I don't want to tell you anything about it. It's only that it electronically slows down the movement of the vocal cords so that we can make out the subtle changes and the vibratory pattern can be examined. So you can always do this to differentiate vocal polyps from the cysts. In vocal cysts, its mucosal wave pattern is absent, whereas in all other diseases, the mucosal wave pattern is decreased or abnormal, whereas in the cyst, it is totally absent. I think I will omit this. Microlaryngoscopy is always done under general anesthesia. You all know this, and it is a must if you are planning any conservation procedures in the larynx. It's one of the requirements before planning a conservation procedures, like a partial laryngectomy. For total laryngectomy, you may not need this, only direct laryngoscope may be adequate. I think with this I will close. If you people have any doubts, if I can clarify, I would like to do that. There is no bypass, sir.
So
if he gets a case of,
if he doesn't get a case of CA larynx
or base of tongue or pyriform, he will be lucky. He may just say ideal normal and examiner is happy. Because we are
not seeing how they are doing in our practical exam.
Yes, doctor, no word, we are not seeing.
Sir, what I tell my PGs, whether they do it or not, I really don't know. I tell that every patient you see, whether it is throat, nose or ear, do two mirror examinations in each one of them, until unless there is a lot of rush sitting on it. Indirect laryngoscopy and posterior laryngoscopy. You have to learn in a normal patient first, and then only you can make out what is abnormal. And then in an ideal patient, you are able to do the ideal. That doesn't guarantee that you will be able to do it well in a difficult case. Sir, it is like a tonsil. Some people in two tonsils they are good. Some people after 100 also still they come in. So I think ideally about 50 indirect laryngoscopies, if they do independently, they will be able to have some say in how to do it. 5, 10, 20 is probably is very inadequate.
Is there any question for you, sir?
It depends upon. I don't want to go against the textbook if they have given, they have some wisdom to say. But even in that position, there is a parallax error when you are looking down. And in my practice, I found that this is the best way. I can tilt the mirror, I can tilt the patient, but if I go up or below, my vision is distorted. Already the laryngeal structures, they are not actual what we are seeing. There is what is 2 centimeters may look as only 1 1.5 centimeter. The depth what we see as 4 mm, 5 mm, it is actually 4 3 centimeters or so. Suppose you do fiber optic also, you think the acoustic tube is about 2 centimeters below the vocal cord. But actually, you measure it is about 5 centimeters. So there is a visual problem in that, and you add this parallax problem, then it becomes difficult. But it is like that. If I am practicing that way all through, then that will be the best for me. But if I combine this or that, then I will be confused. Sir,
Savlam.
only mirror side, never on metal side. And when you heat the mirror on the mirror side, you require less heat. And the metal gets minimal heat from the mirror. But you are touching the soft palate by mistake, is the metal side. So it will be less heat and patient may tolerate. But before that, as I said, you touch on your own back of the hand, not on the palm. You all know the reason why. Sir, if you are heating up, we should use a spirit lamp with absolute alcohol and not the adulterated or kerosene mix one. In that case, I will prefer to dip it in a hot water, or I will like to use a salve.
When you are repeating the metallic side, it is always the slip of the calling the expansion for metal side, it
Theoretically possible.
is a
Yeah,
chance. You have to hold
old mirrors, yes.
a
They are
mirror. Yeah.
expanded.
Yes.
So one more small tip is, when you look into the mirror, if the mirror is not clean, you feel your face is not clean. The same way, before heating it, look at the mirror. Can you see your face through it well? Suppose there are dots, and you will feel those dots are in the larynx. So, and you will not get a correct finding. So, I mean, to be frank, when I was a PG, we were not having many headache cases. So I had to go to Safdarjung Hospital to learn headache from Army Hospital. So when I went there, the first 2 months, I think I was allowed to do around maybe 2 or 3 IVLs. And I think 1 in 2 I was able to do it. And my teacher, you all must be knowing, Devender Roy, he was senior resident there. So he taught me the tips as to how to tilt the mirror, how to keep the patient, how to pose. He used to observe me and tell, "You are doing this, try to change it." So by I think about 2 3 months, I was able to pick up almost all regular cases. But still now, when there is a Christmas, I find it's very difficult. I push it into the one side of the soft palate and try to see, but I can never get a panoramic view of the diaphragm to do it directly. The second thing is, now that we most of us have got fiber optic, when I find it difficult, I don't try it further. Instead of wasting time, I just go back to fiber optic. Hardly seen. I have seen many people doing it as a routine, but I tell people don't do it. You try it, if his gag is there, then only do it. Maybe 1 or 2% people will have that. Once you talk to them, they are confident about you, usually their gag also is less. I think I have crossed 15 minutes. That's why.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for the valuable tips, sir. May I again read books?
Because internet learning is mandatory, it's mandatory. It's mandatory.
What would be the possible magnification of the
question is, what is the possible magnification when you do indirect laryngoscopy? What magnification does the laryngeal nerve give?
It's about 2.
It's about 2x. Is that right? Is the playing field?
It is not a magnification. As I said, it is certain distances are reduced, but the structures like a vocal artery and vocal polyp, which